Good morning, Father.
Good morning. Good morning, Bill. How are you?
Father John Faris from St. Louis, Gonzaga.
Chorbishop.
Chorbishop, and a lot of unhappy people, Chorbishop, right now.
Well, and actually, I'm one of them.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm very much one of them.
You are such a part of this community, and now we're hearing that you're leaving.
Yes, I'm going to be going. Actually, I'm leaving on Sunday afternoon.
Wow.
Wow, so soon.
Yeah, it's very soon. To a parish in Virginia, a suburb of Richmond, Virginia, St. Anthony Church. A lot of people don't know it, but this was my very first parish.
Really?
I have been a priest for 42 years, but I've always been in administration. So when I came to St. Louis Gonzaga, it was with a little bit of trepidation, like, I don't know whether I'm going to be able to do this.
Yeah.
But they trained me well.
Mm-hmm.
The people there, you know, got me in line very quickly. And truly, it's been the best 9 years of my life. It really was an amazing experience.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, everybody when I came, I lived in New York for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And New Yorkers were saying, you can't go there. You just can't go there.
You'll die
there.
Yeah.
That's one person.
They do.
Uncharted territory.
You'll die there. It's north of.
They still have smallpox.
Yeah. And they're north of 125th Street.
Yeah.
But this is a wonderful community. It's a great community to raise kids in. We have wonderful restaurants.
Yeah.
I've been to a few, as you can see, over the years. And the people here are welcoming and warm, and it's really a community.
Yeah.
It's been the best 9 years of my life. I just can't say anything too good about you.
So a lot of these decisions are made
by the bishop.
By the bishop.
By the bishop, yes.
And there's a calling. There's a reason. There's always a reason.
Yes. Well, it demands... When we think about these things, it's painful for me to be uprooted and move elsewhere.
Yeah,
I thought I was going to have to be calling somebody here to find me a retirement home. but the issue is we have to think not simply of our own little community,
our own
personal needs, but the whole church
and
what's needed. And we had some retirements, so it required that... I take a different position.
And one of the things that Chorbishop Faris and I were just discussing off-air is that it's not like in the Roman Catholic Diocese of Syracuse, where if a priest moves from a parish, they go maybe an hour and a half away. With the way the diocese is set up with the Marianites, it could be statewide, one state to the other.
Actually it is. I have an associate pastor, Father Aaron, who is also going to be moving the same day. He's leaving today, in fact. He's going down to Boca Raton, West Palm Beach.
I
tell everybody he's going to have Donald Trump and my mother as two parishioners.
Well, there's plenty of Uticans that are down there.
A lot of Uticans are down there in that parish. So.
And no snow.
No snow.
Can I ask, I understand with the retirement and there's some reassignments that go on, but why is the idea that, you know, you would be better suited here. Maybe someone who's from a different community who hasn't been there as long and isn't as involved would be the choice to go to Virginia. Why you?
Well, in our parishes, you have to think, first of all, about linguistic capability. What languages can you speak? And this parish that I'm going to, I haven't been there in 25 years. I haven't seen the place in 25 years. But when I was in the bishop's office, actually, I assigned the priest who's there now.
Wow.
So, and I also feel that, well, since I was doing the assigning for a while, when you're a soldier again, you have to do what you're told.
Yeah.
So you have all those characteristics. This parish that I'm going to also requires some administrative responsibilities.
So you fit the bill for that.
I can do that.
Yeah.
I can do that.
Will you still continue to, you were traveling. And
I travel, yes.
Yeah.
The people will have to get used to that. That's a big deal. I will have... at least one associate, maybe two, because the young guys usually come spend some time with me. And I'm also teaching at Catholic University.
That's where it was. Yeah.
Right.
So it's in D.C.
In D.C.
Yeah.
So I'll be taking, instead of a plane, I'll be taking Amtrak.
Okay. Well,
good point. Yeah. That's a little more convenient.
That's,
but I'd rather stay here.
A great parish. You guys have done great, great things. I just never realized. My wife is Catholic. I'm not Catholic. Mm-hmm. We were married Catholic.
Yes.
I didn't understand that there's a Roman Catholic and then there's a completely different. I thought all priests were all under one umbrella.
Well, we're under Rome. But we're under a different bishop. Bishop Cunningham is not. We're under Rome, and that's where I used to work. But we're under different bishops, and the territorial boundaries are different.
Speaking of that, and you get asked questions all the time, so mm-hmm. I'll just ask it. This Pope, what are your thoughts?
I love him.
I hear that from priests all the time.
I love it. He's setting the church. He's upsetting some people.
He is.
He's upsetting some people. But when you challenge people's thinking, that upsets people.
Yeah.
He is, I think we're not going to realize all the changes he made if we think this is radical. I think he's setting the church on a completely different
trajectory. He does seem to be. And his comments.
And it's out of necessity, I think. Yes. And it's out of a need for realism in today's society.
And it's really, he's trying to tell people that what we get concerned about is not so important. What we really need to be concerned about are people who are marginalized, who are poor, who are forgotten. That's why that's the church especially.
That
has to be the concern.
This is a topic that came up recently, and you didn't agree with the person, but you understood. You said it was a generational difference, and I think we're seeing some of that in the Catholic Church, where didn't the Pope recently tell someone who was openly gay, God made you that way? And even, I think to some extent, this was reported, and it was somewhat of a significant story, because by saying God made you that way, it takes out the element of the choice and everything. So when you talk about him going on a different path, it seems like maybe some of the parishioners might be a little, I guess his congregation globally, they might, it's a little variance from what they've heard.
The story made the news. So clearly it was a step away from the norm. It's something we've never heard a Pope say before.
Well, I haven't heard the quote.
Yeah.
And I always have to be careful when I hear somebody say the Pope said, because sometimes he's giving interviews and it's not recorded.
Oftentimes the Vatican will come out and clarify what was said, and it might have been the reporter's interpretation.
Exactly.
However,
and sometimes it can be off the cuff.
But I don't think I'd be surprised that this Pope would make that statement.
I would think that his concern is, and I think that's everybody's concern, in America, we are really focused on gender issues all the time.
Yeah.
All the time. That's what we think. America, North America and Europe, well, there are wars going on and all that kind of thing. I think when it comes to sexuality, the Pope is just saying, as you would say to any kid who was in your family, okay, you're gay, you're this, you're that, I love you.
Right, right.
I love you. Whether it came, I don't think the Pope could make a decision, God made you that way, you decided to be that way, culturally, whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah.
I love you.
I think that's big, because think of the parents that have had to face that very decision in the world through history.
Well, actually, as a priest, you see it, and the Pope definitely sees it a different way. When parents will be very vocal and critical, and I'm sitting there thinking, if you only knew what was going on in your own family.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty big.
If you only knew what was going on in your own family, and we have so many problems.
Yeah.
We have so many problems. But I just want to move off the sexualities a little bit. We're too, I to be blunt, I said at one point during the election, we had three wars going on, three major wars that we were involved in. And we were arguing about what bathrooms to use.
Crazy, yeah.
It's talking about this because we can't solve the big problems.
See, we love to follow the little shiny object.
Yeah.
We. And it really takes us off target when we really could be looking at the very meaningful things that are really important in the world.
We're looking for the quarter in the living room, even though we lost it in the kitchen, but the light's better in the living room.
Yeah, that's right. I don't think we've ever had such a deep conversation.
No,
I'm glad we had this. So.
Thank you. And I want to thank you, Bill, and Jack, all of you, for just your support of our program of the Taste of Lebanon, which will be coming up in August again.
Which is awesome.
I will be supporting that.
Excellent, excellent. And just thank you for all the kindnesses you've given us over the years, the opportunity to publicize it. I really appreciate it. You know, I have to say something. I was happy to get the call from Jeff because I thought, boy, I won't get to say goodbye to those guys.
Well, I'm glad you came in.
It's been such a part of my life, too.
And we learned so much, too, as you in your travels. You were able to bring back the stories of horrible stories from around the world.
Yes,
and perspective.
And it gives us, when we sit around here and we're worried about our own little things that are going on, they don't seem so large after all.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
One thing you'll miss about Utica. When you're telling your new parishioners about Utica, what will you tell them?
The people, the warmth. The sense of community. The one thing I would caution Utica people about, okay, I think we all care about each other, but I think because even geographically we live in a valley, we have to look beyond the valley.
That would be insight.
Yeah, that would be what I would.
And refreshing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Chorbishop, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Be sure of my prayers for all of you, and I ask you to pray for me.
The new folks, have them set aside a crate of grape leaves for me, if you could.
I will. I will.
A crate.
Thank you.
Not just a plate.
And let them know down there, we're not all Yankees. So
no.
Some of us are Mets fans.
Exactly.
So, okay. Thank you so much.